Good morning. Morning. Happy birthday. 145 years, looking good. Well done. It's going to be a good day, I think. Thank you for joining us. It's good to see you all as we celebrate this place, as we gather together. Going forward, next Sunday. Is it next Sunday? What day is it? Sunday. It is Sunday. It's the 24th. Therefore, next Sunday, we will be having a collection of breakfast cereals for our food Christmas parcels. If you'd like to bring those along next Sunday morning, we will collect them in. As we go for our Christmas programme, details are about the whole Christmas Advent programme is around. I'd like to highlight a few things. On Sunday the 8th, we have our annual Rotary Charity Concert. There are tickets available at the back at the information point. We're also looking for collectors on Saturday the 7th and Saturday 21st in the city centre. Also, Paul Garwood is drawing up a new rota for our soup run, which happens on a Monday night. If you would like to get a little bit more information or get involved in that, have a chat with Paul. He will find you something to do and tell you all about it. And also, again, a big thank you from Major Anne and Donna. They did their Microlite flight. They'd like to say thank you for the £400 now raised for the Big Connection fundraiser. That is all from me.
Good morning. Good morning. It's good that as we gather together today that our hearts should always be full of praise, but particularly on certain days and on certain weeks, we come with an extra level of praise as we come to give thanks to God for 145 years of the Salvation Army at work, or should I say God at work through the Salvation Army here in Gloucester. And so today may we come with a hearts full of praise and thanksgiving for what is past and what is present, but also as we look to the future. The guys behind me will need no introduction to many of you, but former Corps officers of this Corps, Majors Adrian and Claire Allman, are currently serving as divisional leaders in West Midlands. But they're here with us today to share in worship and just to join in what God is doing in this place. So let's welcome them in the usual way. Thank you.
Well, good morning. It feels a bit weird standing up here, but familiar and comfortable at the same time. It is such a joy to be here with you today. It is a joy for all of us, all four of us Allmans, to be here today and to be together, because that's become a bit of not a very frequent thing in our recent weeks. But it's good to be here to worship with you and celebrate 145 years of God working in this city through the Salvation Army. It is like old times, seeing so many familiar faces, but it's also like new times, seeing new faces as well, which is brilliant and really heartwarming to see. We have so many beautiful memories of our time here in Gloucester, not least the birth of our two girls, Rosie and Katie. Rosie came and I came here a few years ago with the Songsters, Birmingham Citadel Songsters, just before COVID struck. But Katie's never been back since we've left. So she doesn't remember too much, I'm afraid. So if she looks at you a bit blankly, it's not her being rude, that she's just maybe not quite so sure about it. But we're very glad to be here today to celebrate in your anniversary today. And we thank God for his faithfulness throughout those years. He has continued to be a great and victorious God. And today we're here to celebrate that and give him the glory. The paraphrase of Psalm 145 says this, and it should come up on the screen. Let us enlist our lives in continuous celebration of God's goodness and greatness. Let us announce to the world God's presence and proclaim his loving concern for all creatures. How incomparably glorious is our great God. May our mouths articulate and our lives demonstrate his ever-present love for all his creatures. Let us celebrate the eternal mercy and goodness of God. And so as the psalmist suggests, let's celebrate his presence and celebrate the eternal mercy and goodness of God as we sing our opening song, which outlines what made and continues to make the ministry and kingdom building in this core possible, God's love and redemptive work in our lives that makes us free from the power of sin, but also free from the power of cancelled sin, yeah? This what this song says, and able to live life in its fullness. That's worthy of our celebration and our worship of God today. So I invite you to stand if you're able, and we'll sing the great song, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing My Great Redeemer's Praise. Let's really lift our voices in praise this morning as we sing. Thank you, Bama. Please take your seats. We worship a living Lord whose death and resurrection brought us freedom from the power of sin, fullness of life, and a hope of eternity in paradise. Such is his love for us. But sometimes it's really hard to grasp that love, isn't it? Well, I want us to take some moments now to just really bask in the love of God, as the songsters bring to us their ministry, by singing those beautiful words written in red. The song, time after time, reminds us of that love. I love you. I love you. Believe it. I love you. That's what Calvary says. And I really pray today, as you hear this beautiful song and these words, that you will know that love. I love you, written in red. I love you. I love you. Psalm 59, verses 16 to 17 says this, "But as for me, I will sing about your power. Each morning I will sing with joy because of your unfailing love." I love you, remember? "For you have been my refuge, a place of safety when I'm in distress, or my strength. To you I sing praises for you. Oh God, you are my refuge, the God who shows me unfailing love." The psalmist there is telling us what the Lord has done for him in his life. He's giving his testimony of the goodness of God in his life. And as we come into prayer just now, we want to express the goodness of God in our lives. Every day we should do this. But of course, today of all days, on this anniversary celebration, when we consider the work of his work in this city through this core, when we consider all the people, the saints who have gone before and the influences over so many generations, when we consider how he's worked in our lives, each one of us here, and all that he's done in and through us because we have been or we are part of this church, how could we not reciprocate that love by singing, "I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God." And so the worship band are going to help us to sing this beautiful song of love and adoration, the goodness of God to our wonderful God. And then, will there be a freedom of prayer where you can just speak out your praise and thanksgiving to our generous, loving, and faithful God? Will you do that for me? Let's sing. And let Frankie lead us as we sing this beautiful song to God.
That I may go till I am.
But let there be a freedom of prayer just now as we give God our thanks for his goodness.
Lord, we wake up this morning to see the power of the storm, your might, how big a difference you can make to life, how big a difference. Yes, you created the whole universe in all its intricacy and all its vastness, and yet, Lord, you care about each one of us individually. Lord, it is wonderful to know that as we take that leap of faith to trust you, turn to you, we find that you actually want and can help us to do what is best for us. We thank you so much for that personal intimacy. We thank you, Lord, for everything. Amen.
God, we praise you. We gather to worship you, to remember the goodness and unfailing love you have shown to us, your people. Time after time, you have come to our rescue. Your love has sustained us through good times and bad. No matter what we faced, you were there, encouraging, strengthening, and blessing. Even if we turned our back on you, you didn't abandon us, but waited patiently for us to return, ready to welcome us with open arms. Because we've known your love in the past, we look to the days ahead without fear. No matter how uncertain the future may seem, we will continue to trust in your unfailing love, confident that you will guide us in the days ahead, as you've guided us in the past. And so we ask all of these things in the name of Jesus, by whom by his death and resurrection showed a love beyond compare. Amen. As we continue in worship, we're going to listen to the ministry from the band, and Phil's going to share with us what they're going to play.
Plan B for Sunday morning has been selected, as a number of the band have been affected by the power of the storm this morning. And we're going to share with you a march by George Marshall, which continues in that reflection on the mightiness of God, but more importantly, the Saviour and his resurrection. This is Mighty to Save.
Thank you.
sound on him. Thank you. Thank you. I know he's mighty to save, and we thank God today for all the ways he's saved, all the ways, in the many ways in which he saved people in the city of Gloucester through the work of the Salvation Army. Right, I'm looking for some helpers. I can see there's a few people that are down here. Would you like to come and help me? It will be worth your while if you come and help me. It absolutely will. Now, do you know what? For old Simon's sake, I think we need to have Simon here. Yeah. Yes. And I think we'll have Mike as well. Come on, Mike, as well. Right, how many people are here? Let's see. Let's have a wee count to see how many I've got. Mike will be on one team. You will be, Simon, on the other. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Ah, so somebody's... We're going to have a relay race, right? I've heard that on wet and windy days, children's behaviour in school is a nightmare. So I was thinking if we had a bit of running this morning, then that might help, you know, just to calm things down. Or maybe not. Right, okay, so what we're going to do is... 1, 2, 3, 4. You all go in that team with Simon, and you lot go in that team with Mike. Or should we get another person on this side? Who should we ask? Oh, Frankie's here. Thank you. Right. So have you ever done a relay race before? Yes? No? Right. So what we're going to do is we're going to put some of you, so half you, three of you. How many is in a team? Oh, this is... Yeah, half of you go up that end. Just don't do it yet. Do it in a second, right? Half of you go up to the top aisle up there, at the top of the aisle, right? And half of you stay down here. And this is going to be your baton, right? My Percy Pig stirrers. Okay? You start. Okay. So what you're going to have to do, you three, you front three, you're going to go up there. So you go up there now. And you front three go up there now. Go up to where Nathan is. Stay here. That's it. Right, and you stand just like in a nice line. That's it. So what you've got to do, right, you're listening carefully, you've got to run up there to your teammate, give them the baton, which is your spreader thing. They've got to run back, give it to the next person. They've got to run back and give it to the next person, and so on. Do you understand? Yeah. Oh, thank you. Thank you for answering my question. Do you all understand up there? Yes? Do you know what you're doing? Yes? Excellent, thumbs up. Right, are we ready? Let's go, see how we get on. On your marks, get set, go! Come on. Won there, was it this team? Yeah, you confuse me. Right, okay, it's a tie, so we have to do it one more time. So back to your starting places, please. Jings, I'm boiling here. I don't know about you. Oh, the heating works nicely in this hall. Right, are we ready? Oh, no blockages in the aisles. Here we go. Are you ready? Steady, this is for the winner, right? Ready, steady, oh! Amazing. Right. When this meeting, listen to this because this is going to be excellent for you. When this meeting is finished, you need to come and see me because I have got a bag up there that's got some nice things in it for you. But I want to ask some questions of you. When you played that game, can someone tell me what was the most difficult thing about it? Are you going to say something?
Passing the spatula.
Passing the spatula or the baton. Let's call it baton, yeah. Yes, what are you going to say?
You hold the bottom or the top of it, and then the other person. So if you're holding the top, they can grab the bottom.
That's a good idea, isn't it? Did you hear that? He says, if you hold the top, then the next person can grab it from the bottom, and so on and so forth, and that helps to move it, to pass it on well. What about you? What were the bits that you found difficult? The same sort of things, eh?
Getting out the seat.
Oh, well, you are, you know, getting on in life, aren't you? So the hardest bit, and actual fact, we did have someone drop the baton, didn't we? The spatula. Oh, well, I wasn't going to tell everybody who it was, but yeah. It did drop the baton, and that wasted a bit of time for you, didn't it, Paul? But you picked it up, and you kept going again. Thank you so much for your help this morning. Don't forget to come and see me after the meeting, and I will give you something from my little bag. Let's give him a round of applause for helping me this morning. You know, a good track coach, not that I would necessarily know, will tell you that a relay is won or lost in the transfer of the baton. And that's what they said was a difficult bit, wasn't it? The key is doing well in the relay is knowing where you're running to, passing on the baton, and only letting go when the next person has it. Fumble around and you lose time. Drop it and you're in trouble. Don't pass it on and the game's over. With a good handover, you're on track to win. We're all charged to pass on the baton of faith and of the Christian values and of living. And we need to do that in the right way for it to be fruitful in someone else's life. Think about who has passed on the baton of faith to you. What was it about them that encouraged you to take hold of that baton of faith and enter into a relationship with God? Have a think about that. You know, we do this by creating environments where God is happy to send people. And that's through relationships, through living out Christ. There's a number of people here today from when we left that weren't here. And there must have been something about this place and the individuals that you met that made you stay. What was that? And I pray that as individuals and as a church that you'll continue to pass on the baton by creating those environments which God feels comfortable sending people to for the next 145 years and beyond. Well, one way of doing that is by nurturing our children, making it a place where they feel welcome and engaged. And it's beautiful to see so many of them here this morning. And they're going to minister to us just now as they sing a couple of songs for us, Andy. Is that right? Great. We look forward to that.
So if all the kids from the sing group want to join me on the platform, please. We're gonna do a couple of little songs. One is a kind of response song, which we're gonna do. And then we're gonna be singing a song called Amen, which has actions. And the words to this one, and it's a new one, are Amen. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's the Alpha Omega, wonderful Savior. Amen. So we're gonna sing. If anyone else wants to join us, you're more than welcome. And please, give them encouragement at the end. Thank you.
King Jesus is all.
King Jesus is all.
My all in all.
My all in all.
And I know he'll answer.
And I know he'll answer.
Me when I call.
Me when I call.
I'm walking by his side.
I'm walking by his side.
I'm satisfied.
I'm satisfied.
King Jesus is all.
King
Well done, young people. You sang very well. Thank you there. From the ministry of some small people, we're going to read in the Bible about a small man just now. We're going to look at Luke chapter 19, a very familiar story to many of you here. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but being a short man, he could not because of the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost." In our Bible reading, Jesus created an environment through relationship with Zacchaeus that he felt comfortable to invite him to his house and to invite him into his life. And so Adrian's going to share some thoughts on that in a few moments. But let's sing together a song that recognizes the need for us to pass on the baton of faith so God's kingdom building in Gloucester continues to be fruitful. By creating those environments, God feels comfortable sending people to. And so we're going to sing together a song that says, "Build your kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand. Heal our streets, our land. Set your church on fire. Win this nation back. Change the atmosphere. Build your kingdom here, we pray." The worship band are going to help us sing this. I'm going to ask you to stand if you're able. And let's really sing out this prayer that God would build his kingdom here. That this place would be a comfortable place that God feels to send his people to. Thank you, Frankie.
Oh, Thank you so much. It's great to be here. It doesn't seem like 8 years at all since I was last on this platform. It seems like 8 months ago. And it's great to see so many faces that I know, but it's equally great to see so many faces I do not know. God is good. God is still sending people to us. You know, a few weeks ago, I had one of those moments that sent me back in time, and it was not for the better. Ever since Rosie's been at senior school, she's always been keen to join the school musical. So in the first 3 years, we've had Matilda, we've had Legally Blonde, we've had Annie, and at the beginning of term, she bounced into the house to announce what this year's school musical was. And she said, do you know what we're doing this year? No, you're going to tell us, aren't you? We are doing Frozen the Musical. You're joking. I looked at Claire, she looked at me, because we knew exactly what that meant. We were here when that movie first came to the cinema. Claire, I think Claire and Becky took them to the cinema to see that film. I did not go. However, I lived it for the next 2, 3, 4 years. Everything seemed to be Anna. Everything seemed to be Elsa. What was that, Snowman Olaf? And what was worse, and this was the shock when she announced it was Frozen, what was worse, I knew what was coming. The endless playing of Let It Go, Let It Go, oh no, here we go. I'd had the musical equivalent of detox just to remove that from my system. But no, it's back. And in our house, it's back. I thought it had gone, but it's back. In fact, it's quite surreal in our house because Rosie's school musical is Frozen, so I get, do you want to build a snowman? Katie's school musical is Grease, so I've got from her room, I've got chills, they're multiplying. So it's quite surreal at this moment in our time. You know, if ever there was a soundtrack for a passage of scripture, then Let It Go is totally appropriate for Luke chapter 19. To let go of oneself is to become unrestrained, to abandon one's inhibitions. And as Jesus came into Jericho en route to Jerusalem, we're introduced to this tax collector, this man called Zacchaeus. Now, there's lots of things we already know about tax collectors. They were hated. They were despised. They were seen by fellow Jews as traitors because they'd gone to work for the Romans. They were wealthy. They used ruthless methods to tax people whenever, wherever. You could be in the street, you could bump into a tax collector. He would tax you on what you had in your possession. You could walk into the street next door, bump into another tax collector. He would do exactly the same. You could bump into three by the time you got home with your shopping. These people were not light. They were bullies. In the open, they were protected. The Roman soldiers would protect them. However, a tax collector would risk their life by getting caught up in the middle of a surging crowd. Jesus comes into town. He comes into town. And around him, there's a crowd. For this little man, Zacchaeus, this was a dangerous thing to even be anywhere near this crowd. Let's be frank, if you wanted vengeance against a man who'd ruined your life, left you penniless, where would be the best place to do it? In the middle of a crowd where you could do him harm and nobody would see it. And so most tax collectors would have been quite restrained. They wouldn't have gone close to a large unsupervised crowd as this. But Zacchaeus, it tells us in verse 3, he wanted to see who Jesus was. And yet he's got the dilemma. He doesn't want to be noticed. And yet he's eager to find meaning in his own life through Jesus. And so what he's got to do is let go. First of all, he's got to let go of his fears. And then he's got to let go of his inhibitions. He's a short man, but he's not thick.
He knows what he needs to do. He's not going to see over a crowd from the back. So what's he got to do? He's got to get ahead of the crowd. That's what he's got to do. And then he's got to get above the crowd. But he's also got to keep a comfortable distance. And so what does he do? It is an astonishing thing. He runs, finds a sycamore tree, and he climbs it. Now, let me just ask you a question. How many adults in the room have recently climbed trees? Anybody? Listen, if climbing trees is not an adult behaviour now, 2,000 years ago, it was nowhere near an adult behaviour. Even running was not an adult behaviour. This is a man who's letting go of his inhibitions. In fact, these were the behaviours of a child. That's what he was doing. He was behaving like a kid. He was running. He was climbing trees. But actually, what was he also doing? He was reducing his own status here. You know, we often talk about the high and mighty falling. Well, this was actually the high and mighty bringing himself down a peg or two. By shinning up a tree, he's reducing himself to the status of a child. And yet, do you know what? That little humbling act would be the best place from which he could receive and welcome Jesus. That act of humbling himself. He'd not been around when Jesus had to settle the argument with the disciples about who would be the greatest. What did Jesus say? He took a child and he said, whoever humbles himself like me, whoever receives me like this little child. And isn't this what Zacchaeus is doing? He's suddenly going into the mind of a child in order to see Jesus. You know, we think that Zacchaeus' act was out of the blue, unexpected. Well, so was Jesus's. Just think about it for a minute. As Jesus gets to the foot of this tree, he does something that nobody was expecting him to do. He lets go of convention. He lets go of the crowd's expectation. And what does he do? He looks up and he calls the chief tax collector by name, Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus, come down. I'm coming to your house today. That's what he says. Now, I can imagine that tax collectors were called lots of things, but rarely their name. And yet here, a man who he'd never met before calls out to him by name. Jesus' request is direct, it's intentional, there's a sense of urgency. And whatever the crowd think of that, he just puts them to one side, he lets them go. And he actually makes it very clear that he's pleased to be able to come to Zacchaeus' house. And there at the house we get this astonishing change of behaviour. You and I will have read Luke chapter 19 so many times. You'll have read this story so many times. But have you ever noticed that when reading this, Zacchaeus never, ever confesses his sin or repents? Not once. He does not confess his sin, nor does he repent. Now, you could say that actually this change of behaviour of giving everything back is a sign of repentance. But actually, there's no confession of his sin there. And equally so, Jesus does not respond by commending such a wonderful change of heart in this man. He just simply pronounces a blessing. He says, today, salvation has come to this house because this man too is a son of Abraham. I think a lot of people hold Luke 19 up as a wonderful blueprint for repentance and forgiveness. I'm not so sure it is. But what I do think it is a demonstration of the most important attribute for any follower of Jesus. That we should have a constant, strong desire to see Jesus and that we should experience joy from being in his presence. That's what this story's about. This man had a desire to see Jesus. And when this man, Jesus, came to his house for tea, he was overjoyed. At this time of the year, when we were in our last appointment at Birmingham Citadel, it was always that time of the year when certain families in our congregation were eagerly looking forward to getting away for the winter because they had children who lived overseas. We had a lot of families that lived in New Zealand, lots of families that lived in other parts of the world. And as these people were coming up to me and shaking my hand, how are you doing? You could tell that they were desperately excited because it was only a matter of weeks away before they were going to see their family overseas. It changed their whole demeanor. You could see it in their face. There was this whole real excitement that they were going to see their family. Zacchaeus can't see Jesus because he's too short, both physically and morally. The crowds impede his sight. Yet this rich tax collector is so desperate to see Jesus that he's not deterred. He humiliates himself by climbing under a tree in order to glimpse over the crowd and see Jesus. He's as excited as anybody else to see Jesus. And I wonder if we as disciples of the Lord always have that desire when we get up in the morning, that we are so excited in our desire to see Jesus. For me, this story, there is a promise, and it's a promise that anyone who desires to see Jesus will. Anyone who desires to see Jesus will. And more than that, anyone who desires to see Jesus will in turn be seen by Jesus. Jesus could have come along, ignored what was going on in a tree above him, but he didn't. He met this guy's desire to see him with the desire to see Zacchaeus. And there, he went to his home, they had afternoon tea, and there God was pleased to dwell. You know, in recent years, this very thought of developing places where God has been pleased to dwell has occupied my thinking more and more and more. You know, God created man to be in relationship with him. He delights to dwell with his people. We're told that in the scripture. And this idea of creating a place where God is pleased to dwell has been something that's been at the forefront in my ministry as a core officer. Amidst all the clamor of creating strategies, developing mission plans, surely the most important work of any worshiping congregation is to create an environment where God is pleased to dwell. Isn't it? To create an environment where God is pleased to dwell and where God is happy to send people to. 8 years ago, we moved to Birmingham. I can remember the day vividly. I remember the day following the Pickfords van out of Churston Court, leaving Jackie on the driveway, waving goodbye. And as we went, we still hadn't got our girls into school. We went up to Birmingham and we were desperate to try and get our girls into school. We went into various schools, and each school that we went into, each nursery that we went into, what was our criteria? Our criteria was simple. Would this be a place where we would be happy to send our girls? And that's what we made a judgment upon. I often think that God sends people to places where he's happy to send people to, where he is happy to dwell. any growth we experienced in our last core at Birmingham Citadel wasn't down to us. Wasn't down to the people. It was because we created a place where God was happy to dwell and where he, in turn, was happy to send people to. This little story about Zacchaeus. Jesus was happy to dwell in the home of this little man. Why share Zacchaeus on a day like today, a church anniversary? Well, for me it's appropriate because it tells me two things. It tells me about a man who had a strong desire to see Jesus, that he was willing to abandon his inhibitions, and as a result of seeing and meeting Jesus, he experienced joy from being in the presence of God. Now, isn't that what the people of this core have been doing for 145 years? I can picture them. I can picture the people that were in this hall when we arrived here. 9 years ago, whenever it was. People's faces, different faces. But why were they there? They were there because they had a desire to see Jesus, and they had great joy in meeting him in this place. Friends, if I have to say, I can say anything to you on your core anniversary, never lose the desire to see Jesus. And never lose the desire to experience the joy of his presence. And may that be your motivation for coming. Always. Always. But the story about Zacchaeus also tells me that the home of Zacchaeus was a place where God was happy to dwell. Anniversaries are always a time to remember God's presence in our church in the past, but also remind ourselves of what church is going forward. And yes, I believe that the people who've gathered throughout its history have had a desire to see Jesus and have experienced joy from being in his presence in this place. And what I'd also like to think is that God has been pleased to dwell here for the last 145 years. And you know what fills me with great hope is, I believe he'll be happy to dwell here going forward. But that's up to us, isn't it? Because we've got to create the environment where God is pleased to dwell. That's what Zacchaeus did. There's nothing special about this little guy. He simply gave the Saviour of the world a cup of tea, or whatever the biblical equivalent 2,000 years ago was. He created a place where God was happy to dwell. And so, friends, as we move forward, the desire to see Jesus and experience joy from his presence is still our motivation, isn't it? Isn't it? And let's do all that we can to make sure that this is a place where God is pleased to dwell and happy to send people to. You know, there are places in the Bible where the glory of the God did depart from the people. He did depart from places. May it not be so for this core that we call Gloucester Core. May this always be a place where God is happy to dwell. Let's think about it as we sing a song, a beautiful song, that just encourages us to be still and to recognize actually in this place God is here. Be still for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here, has been for 145 years, hopefully will be for the next 145 years, but that's up to us. We create the environment where God is happy to dwell. So in our quietness, let's just recommit ourselves, shall we? Let's recommit to having that strong desire like Zacchaeus, to to see Jesus, that we're willing to abandon any inhibitions, willing to let go of things that stop us from doing that. And may we experience joy in this place from being in his presence. And may we recommit on this anniversary Sunday to making this a place where God is pleased to dwell. Let's sing together. Let's remain seated to sing. And let's just know God's presence in the room. Thanks, Cliff. Somebody walked into Birmingham Citadel a few months ago and said, what are you trying to achieve here? Looked me in the eye, said, what are you trying to achieve here? My response was simple. Well, I'm just trying to create a place where God is pleased to dwell and where he's happy to send people to. And may that be so of all of us, wherever we are. May the power of the Lord, the stillness of the Lord, always be moving in this place, because he's always happy to dwell here and always happy to send people to it. Let's pray together. Gracious God, on this anniversary Sunday, it's a simple message you've brought to us. It's a simple message about having a strong desire to find you, to seek you. And as a result of seeing and meeting you, experiencing the abundant joy that is ours whenever we are in your presence. But it's also about a very simple message about creating a place where you are pleased to dwell. And today we are so grateful to celebrate and remember the saints that have passed through this place, the times in this place where you have been glorified, showing that you've been pleased to be part of it and dwell here. And as we look forward to the future, may this always be our aim, to create a place where you're happy to dwell and happy to send people to. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. God's glory has been in this place, And we thank him for that glory. We thank him for those things that he's done. And in our closing song this morning on our anniversary Sunday, we choose an old song. But it's a great song because it gives us the chance to praise him that he's been here, that he's been working, that he's been doing things, and that he still is. Because that's the important thing. Anniversaries aren't about looking backwards. They're about looking backwards to be inspired to look forward. And that's what this is all about. And so today we say to God be the glory, great things you've done in this place. So loved you the world that you sent your son and he's been working out his will and purposes through us for 145 years. He's going to do it even more. Let's stand if you're able and we'll finish our meeting this morning with a great song of praise together. Thanks, Phil. Friends, may we always be seekers. May we always be seekers. May we always create a place here where God is pleased to dwell. And as we do that, may the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make his face shine upon us and be gracious unto us. And may the Lord lift up his countenance upon us and give us his peace now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you.